What do you want if you don't want Herman? What do you want if you don't want Herman?
In 1960, British pop was in a critical condition. Rock and roll had been given a suit and tie and invited onto the variety circuit.
The English music scene just seemed so kitsch. It was all very contained. Emotionally, it was very contained. There didn't really seem to be any excitement about it.
But a more urgent brand of music was gradually being imported from America that was to have a profound effect on the British scene. Blues.
Oh, smokes that lightning.
It was to be the inspiration for groups as diverse as the Yardbirds and Manfred Mann, John Mayall's Blues Breakers and Cream, Blind Faith and Led Zeppelin. Not that it was easy to come by.
I can remember walking 3 miles to see a John Lee Hooker album cover, which a man had, and he brought to the front door to show me. You know, I didn't hear it or anything. I just sort of knocked on his door and said, "You've got a John Lee Hooker album." It was so difficult to hear anything.
The first British blues band was Alexis Corner's Blues Incorporated. Their most important gig was on a Saturday night underneath an ABC tea shop in Ealing.
I can remember meeting people from all over Britain at the Ealing Club. And of course the camaraderie was fantastic. There was a real... You belonged to a society. It was a fairly secret... wasn't intending to be a secret society, but there were so few of us in those early days.
By the time the Ealing Club was established, Blues Incorporated contained 3 refugees from the esoteric and unprofitable world of British jazz. Saxophonist Dick Hextall-Smith, bass player Jack Bruce, and drummer Ginger Baker. They would have a crucial influence on the development of the R&B boom.
We decided that the only way we were going to really make some money was to go commercial, you know? And we made a deliberate plan to go commercial. And sort of start playing, you know, like rhythm and blues as opposed to jazz. It just took off, and it was a whole new thing. Half the band was straight blues players and half the band was straight jazz players. And sort of when we all played together, like the effect we had on each other was amazing.
Another similarly minded outfit began at an unlikely venue for an aspiring jazz band. Butlin's Clacton.
Mike Hugg was then playing vibes and I was playing piano in the group, and that's how we met. The South Seas Bar at Butlin's. It's laughingly called a holiday camp. We were attempting to play music that the audience thought was relaxing afternoon or evening music, but which we wink wink nod nod thought was jazz. We tried very, very hard to turn living as a jazz group. And it was Mike Hugg, to his credit, who suggested that we form a rhythm and blues band.
The Rolling Stones were the first homegrown rhythm and blues band to taste real success. Their gigs at the Crawdaddy Club, based in a pub in Richmond, began to attract other aspirant blues musicians.
At a gig at the Station Hotel, I was introduced to Eric Clapton, who was there, you know, to see the Stones as well, and we got talking. We formed a band which lasted for about 6 months called the Roosters, but we just couldn't find a bass player. And this was 1963, the summer. By the winter of 1963, I mean, you could take your pick of people who wanted to play bass in a rhythm and blues band.
When the Rolling Stones outgrew their residency at the Crawdaddy, another local band, the Yardbirds, were ready to take their place. By now, the band contained former Rooster Eric Clapton, who had attended the same school as rhythm guitarist Chris Dreyer, and new singer Keith Ralph from Art College. He was recruited just before the Yardbirds auditioned for Giorgio Gomelski, who ran the Crawdaddy.
We did an audition rehearsal, whatever, across the road, and he appeared, and he seemed to know what he was doing.
He was in the lineup when Giorgio Gomelski came down to the rehearsal room, and we did about 4 or 5 numbers, and he said, "Okay, babies, next Saturday, you're off."
When we played, everyone seemed to take to him in the audience, and he sort of had his little group of fans.
Another key figure in the blues scene was working as a graphic artist in Manchester and playing blues as a hobby.
there wasn't any suggestion in my mind that you could earn a living from it. So it wasn't until I was 30 when Alexis Corner and Cyril Davis created a market for blues publicly that what I'd always played then became relevant.
John was very much the very intense sort of band leader. We'd arrive at a gig, we'd set up, we'd just run through a couple of things. There's no such thing as sound check, because I think there was a vocal mic and the PA, and that was that. So then we'd drift off to the bar or go and have something to eat. John would then go and stand outside the entrance with a clicker and click how many people actually came in. And then at the last minute, run in and jump on stage and we'd start playing.
I've always loved being a band leader, and it helps to have a fuller understanding of really what life on the road is like, and what creating music is like, and personal relationships and diplomacy and all those things that you have to learn if you're a leader.
Each big city had its own R&B clubs. Every weekend, vanloads of musicians, most of them holding down day jobs during the week, would head out to all corners of Britain.
We would never stay overnight anywhere. We'd get in this van, and John had built three bunk beds in the back. So we had all the gear in the end of the van. A driver, John sat in the front, or quite often lay on one of these bunks, and we'd take turns in the front seat. And we'd drive all the way back from Newcastle and get home about 5 in the morning, go to sleep, get up, leave about midday the next day for Birmingham. And so it went on.
Not everyone was travelling in the same direction. In 1964, Cyril Davis, the co-founder of Blues Incorporated, got fed up with the increasingly jazzy sound of the band and left. He was replaced by one of the most colourful characters on the British jazz scene, Graham Bond. Soon he, Ginger Baker and Jack Bruce began to play as a trio on their nights off. The band within a band was soon to strike out on its own.
We were doing a gig at the Flamingo, and it was Saturday rehearsal, and I arrived to see Graham was talking to Alexis on stage, and then Jack arrived, and Graham came up and went, "That's it, I've left. We've left." I said, "What do you mean we've left? It's all right. Alexis is cool, it's okay." And Graham had in fact left the Alexis Corner band for the three of us without even consulting us.
And I turned up for the gig, and Alexis was really strange. He was like really cold, and it turned out that I had left the band. Alexis didn't. 10 years or more went by. He never forgave me for that for years and years. That was Graham. He pulled a stroke. He just pulled a stroke. Graham was always pulling strokes.
I remember a gig we did at the Marquee where we were getting 40 quid a gig, right? And we used to pack the Marquee out. And this particular day, I remember at the end of the gig, I'm packing up my drums, and John G, the manager, come up, and he's absolutely livid, because apparently Graham had picked the money up before the gig and then picked the money up again after the gig from two different people.
As R&B music became commercially viable, others on the scene began to realise that jazz trappings were a hindrance to success. The Man Hug Blues Brothers, now containing Paul Jones, still had several horn players in the band. One of them, saxophonist Mike Vickers, saw the way the wind was blowing.
Mike Vickers learnt the guitar in a matter of a few weeks to make us more competitive with the kind of band that we saw becoming successful. They seemed all to be approximately 4, 5, 6 pieces, and there we were 7 and sort of, you know, a little bit unwieldy. So we decided, I think we decided to slim down to 5, and in order to be more like the sort of band that was getting more successful. And at this point, I think we really were chasing commercial success.
The next step was to recruit a new bass player, the original incumbent having been judged too jazzy. A friend of Paul Jones, ex-rooster Tom McGuinness, was approached.
Basically, they said, "Do you promise to play simply if you join us as our bass player?" And hand on my heart, I said, "Yes, I do," because I'd never played bass in my life.
The Manhug Blues Brothers were signed to EMI. The house producer liked the band, but not its name.
John Burgess said, "You're sitting on the best name. You couldn't think of a better name than Manfred Mann for a group." We said, "But it's his name. You might just as well call the group Mike Vickers." He said, "No, Manfred Mann is a wonderful name for a group."
To me, it sounded a bit of a silly idea, because you have Manfred Mann's this, or you have, you know, it just didn't sound like a name. But John absolutely insisted.
So we came up with this dummy nonsense about how we were all Manfred. Which one of you is Manfred? Five hands go up, you know. And then we did this 5-4-3-2-1 thing, of course, when each person held up the number of fingers that he was in the band.
The band's identity crisis inspired their first top 10 hit in January 1964, 5-4-3-2-1.
We made the first record casually, sat around a room. I said, "Why don't we count down like a rocket?" And somebody said, "How about chucka chucka chuck?" And then Paul said this, it was me, Mike, and Paul, and something came out the end, and there was the record. What astonished me was people were interviewing me like we made some sort of musical breakthrough, which, you know, was to us it was just a fun song. You know, suddenly we'd made it, you know. But I didn't realize we'd only made it for 3 months and you had to do it again. That I didn't know.
Now we're together nearly every single day singing.
Manfred Mann did do it again. Do Wah Diddy went to number one on both sides of the Atlantic.
Got into making hit singles rather than being a rhythm and blues band, and we left the whole club scene behind. Over the space of about 6 months, we dropped all these residencies and just got into what was really like a pop routine, you know.
We went back to a club called the Ealing Club, after Do What Did He, because we decided that, well, we started off in the Ealing Club. It was one of the places we'd played regularly, perhaps on a Friday, I can't remember. We decided to go back and play, and we thought we were doing the right thing and the nice thing. And we'd go back and we'd play as we played before, you know, for the promoter, the guy who ran the club. The resentment from the audience was just horrendous, as we'd, you know, we'd presumably sold out and become pop stars.
Oh, we're so happy.
The hit single was the crucial thing. You had to have it, really. Because you saw yourselves in competition constantly with the Stones and the Animals and probably not with the Beatles because they were so huge, you know. But with the Stones and the Animals and the Hollies and the Searchers and the Spencer Davis group.
A record would come out. Sometimes they would immediately go in, but after that I remember them coming out and looking at who else was coming out at the same time. You think, Jesus, all these people are coming. And then you'd switch on the radio and it's not there.
The Yardbirds too were aiming for a higher profile. After releasing several unsuccessful blues singles, it became clear that a new ingredient was needed to crack the charts. Pop. They found the winning combination with a song called For Your Love.
It didn't take long to cut, but at the end of the session, it was like, you know, the feeling was, this is something special, there's nothing out there like this. For Your Love suited the band's personality, or most of the band's personality. It unfortunately just didn't suit Eric. He was a purist, you know, he wanted, you know, a purist sound, and the idea of bringing in a harpsichord and congas and things like that just wasn't in his parameters.
One interested observer was impressed by a different aspect of the record.
Eric didn't really stand out until I heard the B-side of the For Your Love single, Got to Hurry, which was strictly an Eric guitar instrumental, and that was the one that, of course, was just blew me away.
Roger Dean played guitar with us at that time, and he was, I think it's fair to say, that he was from the Chet Atkins School of Blues, which means that he wasn't really, you know, a great blues player. John got John McVie and I to sit around a jukebox to listen to the B-side of For Your Love. The solo was pure Chicago blues. And on the strength of that, John said, this is the man we want.
The only disappointed person, of course, was Roger, who was a bit taken aback because he was a very loyal band member and real nice guy, you know, but I mean, the music for me always has to come first, and that was just one very, very special instance where, you know, I just had to have Eric because he was the only person, as far as I was concerned, who had a clue as to what the blues was really all about.
It was probably John's first of many sort of sackings, which were very short and swift. I mean, he wasn't for the drawn out sort of notice. It was like, well, Eric's coming in, you're fired.
Personnel changes were also about to hit the Graham Bond organisation, which, along with R&B, was still playing occasional jazz gigs with poet Pete Brown. Graham Bond's unorthodox approach to the role of bandleader was beginning to disturb his associates.
Graham aggravated so many people that could have done him good, because he fought them, because he was an anarchist, and he would subvert managements and agencies, and of course then he was untogether and he did funny strokes like you know, spending everybody's money and you know, all sorts of stuff like that.
At this time I had a graph on the wall of my earnings and it suddenly plummeted when we started with the Graham Bond organisation. And I remember phoning Graham up and complaining, oh, we're doing better than we were with Alexis. I said, no, Graham, you are, but we're not, you know.
A palace revolution ensued, and Ginger Baker took over the running of the band. Guitarist John McLaughlin was the first casualty of the new regime.
I fired John. John was a moaner. And like you go, oh man, I can't stand any more of this. Oh, this is too much. And, I, and one day, just like I wasn't in a very good mood, and I said, well, why don't you fuck off then? And he did. And then we got Dick.
Dick Hextall-Smith joined just in time to make an appearance in a British feature film, Gonks Go Beat. The film did little to solve the band's basic problem.
What really makes a difference is that it never had a hit. A lot of people tried very hard to get it on the right lines, hit-wise.
We tried our damnedest to have hits, but because of the way we looked, there was no way we could have hits. I think that's what it was. Plus some very, I mean, rather strange choices of things like Tammy as a single.
Tammy, I think I'm in love.
Tammy was not a success. The pressure on the band was increased by a workload of 300 odd gigs a year. Life became more difficult when what was to become a legendary rivalry between Ginger Baker and Jack Bruce started to come to the surface.
You know, they're doing musical things to each other where Ginger's going, right, try that. You know, I'm going to really drop you in it now because I'm going to drop three beats just when I come into that break. I'm going to go, and I'm going to stop it, and then you're going to really have to do something there, otherwise you're really in the shit. You know, and it's like, it was entirely based on this incredible competitiveness between the two of them, you know.
I always looked on Ginger as my sort of big brother. He's about 3 years older than me, which is quite a large gap if you're 17 or 18. And he was very experienced, he was married, and he knew all this African stuff. So he was definitely a mentor, and I looked up to him a lot. But, you know, he can be a little fiery at times.
Jack started getting very out of hand on stage, and in the end he had to go, and because I was the hard man in the band, I got the job of firing him.
I didn't accept that, since I was a founder member of the band. I thought it wasn't fair, and I'd always had this really too highly developed sense of fairness. So I kept turning up, I kept just turning up. on my own, separate from the band, and playing. Until finally Ginger pulled a knife and remonstrated with me.
Jack Bruce began a brief odyssey around the British blues scene, starting with a stint with John Mayall's Blues Breakers. His arrival occurred shortly before a strange interlude in Eric Clapton's period with the band, during which he embarked on an extended sabbatical in Greece.
I liked it at the beginning when Eric was still there, and then when Eric went on his world tour, we had another guitar player, and it was just a different kind of approach. So I don't think I really fat into that band too well.
He was only in it for 3 months, and then Manfred Mann made him a better financial offer, and he left almost overnight.
The vacancy had occurred because Mike Vickers had left, and Tom McGuinness had seized his chance to switch back to guitar, leaving the group a bass player short.
We all said, we want to get Jack Bruce, he's the best bass player around. And Manfred said, I can't ask him, John's my neighbour, you know, I can't. And then we kept badgering and saying, no, he's the one, you know, we've got to get him.
I came in at the last minute and I learned the whole set. I mean, I played the whole set without rehearsal. I think that impressed them. Just went on because they didn't have a bass player and played Do I Did He Right Off, you know what I mean? No probs.
Jack was miscast, poor sod. I mean, he was in a band. I mean, we were kind of, some of us had a jazz background and we were edging that way ever so slightly. Jack was a great bass player and his abilities were irrelevant to what we were doing.
He was, in fact, quite impossible to play with at times, and we often could not literally follow him. You know, we'd all be looking at each other and going, where is one? Where is one? One, two, three, four. he was completely wasted playing Pretty Flamingo. But he did that pretty well.
Shortly after Jack Bruce joined, disaster struck. Paul Jones announced that he wanted to leave the band.
Towards the end of my time with the Manfreds, we had gone into sort of cabaret type stuff to see, how it would feel and whether we could enjoy and satisfactorily and financially rewardingly work that kind of situation. And I think as a group it didn't really work. And I was keen to see whether in fact I could make a difference to that by working those places on my own.
EMI acted quickly to rescue the situation.
Our 3-year contract was up, and they signed Paul, and they wouldn't sign us. We sneakily thought they were probably right, because it's very difficult for a successful band to replace a very, very popular lead singer. I mean, Paul was the sex symbol of the band.
We were kind of written off, and it was very, very difficult. And it was a very stressful... I mean, I had 2 children. It wasn't just about being successful and famous by this time. It was about how do you pay the mortgage? How do you feed your kids? And it's all going to evaporate to nothing. I mean, I remember saying quite categorically that I was the person taking the risk and that... it would be fine for them. After all, they had taken nearly a year to find my replacement. They must have been fairly happy by then.
Mike Darbo was selected to take over as lead singer, and Paul Jones was finally allowed to leave. Now signed to another label, the new lineup started work.
When Paul put a single out, we would be looking at the charts and saying, where's Paul got to with Bad Bad Boy? Are we doing better than him? And where's Semi-Detached Suburban Mr. James? Originally called Semi-Detached Suburban Mr. Jones when we were given the song. But we didn't want anyone to think we were sort of having any sort of go at Paul. And that came out and that got to number 2. And we really felt like, there, we can do it without Paul. Ha ha, said the clown. Has the king lost his crown? Is the knight being tied on romance? Ha ha, said the clown. Is it bringing you down that you've lost your chance?
The Yardbirds, meanwhile, had found themselves with a hit single and no guitarist to play it. They recruited Jeff Beck, a rising star of the West London band scene.
He was into everything from, you know, Chet Atkins to the blues to rock. I mean, he had a great range of things that he loved to play. He was just the perfect guitar player for us at that stage in what we were doing.
We sort of wanted to progress from the blues and play something a bit more, a bit more interesting. And he could play all those different styles and make all those strange sounds.
In 1966, the Yardbirds' bass player and producer, Paul Samuel Smith, decided to retire from the road. He was replaced by top sessions guitarist Jimmy Page. After a short time on bass, Jimmy Page and Chris Dreyer swapped instruments, and the Yardbirds had two lead guitarists.
It was quite competitive. They were obviously trying to outdo each other, and they'd, you know, sort of have some of their solos they took in turn, and then, or some others they all just played at once, so it's quite, you know, it's got a bit hairy at times.
Jeff Beck left in the middle of an American tour, and Jimmy Page took over as sole lead guitarist. By the mid-60s, the blues boom had reached high tide, and psychedelia was beginning to take over as the music of the moment. But one indisputably great British blues album was still to emerge. John Mayall's Blues Breakers with Eric Clapton.
Everyone was tested prior to recording, but the only one who gave any trouble was Eric, because he was playing through his amp, his Marshall amp, exactly as he would have played on stage, which was with considerable distortion and considerable feedback on solos. I don't know if their equipment couldn't cope with it or what it was, or they just weren't prepared for it. So they spent a long time asking Eric to clean the sound up, to do it from the amp and let them do any kind of trickery at their end. And Eric would have none of it. He said, "This is how I play." Eric had an amazing charisma at that time. I think he very quickly realized that as he was getting more and more of a star billing in the Blues Breakers, that was where he was destined, that he wanted some kind of personal success.
The Graham Bond organization, meanwhile, was failing to fulfill its promise. Graham Bond's increasing addiction to heroin was beginning to take a heavy toll.
He did say this horrible thing to me once when we were on the way to a gig somewhere, where he said to me that he decided, when I can't remember how old he would have been, but in his 20s, I would have said, and he said that he decided that he wanted to die, but he wanted to do it very slowly just in case he changed his mind.
You know, I was a junkie, sort of, before the band even started, but I'd sort of seen the light, and I was working very hard. I decided that I was going to get straight, and Graham was going the other way. Graham was getting more and more into everything, and, you know, it ended up, whereas before, you know, like Graham and I used to sit down and discuss, you know, policy and gigs and everything, and it ended up with Graham saying, "Oh, well, you know, like, you do it, Ginge," and just leaving everything to me. And I thought, well, you know, I might as well get my own thing together, you know. I just decided I'd go and see Eric, see if he wanted to join my band, as the plan was. And then we were sort of discussing a bass player, and Jack came out, and I went, oh, no. But I thought, well, you know, maybe Jack's sort of all right. Ginger drove up in his new Rover, which was very impressive, and asked me, you know, without a knife, if I would like to join this band. So of course I jumped at the chance. I thought I'd missed playing with Ginger, obviously. I'd missed his company as well, in a strange way. And yeah, it sounded like a good idea.
There weren't three musicians like us around. You know, that's how the name came about. We considered that we were the cream.
It was a very well-kept secret until it was exposed in the Melody Maker, I think it was, and John Mayall hit the roof.
I wasn't totally surprised, but of course it was a setback, but it's one that you have to deal with if you're a band leader. You expect all these things to happen, and you deal with them accordingly.
Eric Clapton's departure from the Blues Breakers was shortly followed by that of drummer Huey Flint.
I just wasn't very happy in that band after Eric left anyway. And John just rang me up one day and said, I've got another drummer. And I said, oh, right. And he said, but play on Saturday night, that's your last gig, which happened to be at the Marquee. And he said, I'm afraid things have not been so good the last few weeks, so instead of £25, it's only £20 you're getting in your wages this week. He actually gave me a fiver short on, instead of a gold watch.
Cream was an instant success.
I had absolutely no idea that Eric was as popular as he was. You know, I just dug him. I liked him very much as a person, and I really, like, his playing was just very unusual. He had time. We just took over the Graham Bond circuit, worked with Cream. But whereas we'd had like 800 people with Graham, when we went on the same circuit with Cream, there was 800 people in the gig and another 800 people outside the gig. It was a similar thing to the Alexis Corner thing, in a way, and Eric was a straight blues player, and Jack and I were both jazz players.
In 1967, Cream went to the United States and quickly became the biggest attraction on the American tour circuit. The Yardbirds, too, had found their biggest market across the Atlantic, but after several tours, they'd become disillusioned with life on the road.
The touring had become very arduous and really quite uncivilized. And we were probably too young and not in a strong enough position, ironically enough, to say, this is, you know, stop this. I want to get off this for a while. Let's take 3 months off. Let's take 6 months off, you know. It was still the era. If you stopped doing it, you'd be forgotten.
It was really Keith and I that got really quite fed up with it. And we thought, you know, let's do something more melodic, a bit more soft. Let's go in another direction.
In 1968, in the middle of an exhausting American package tour, the Yardbirds split. Two very different groups emerged.
Jimmy hadn't been in the band too long. He was still fresh. He hadn't been through what we'd been through. And he wanted to carry on with the band.
Jim McCarty and Keith Relf formed the classical rock group Renaissance. Jimmy Page, with three comparative unknowns, formed what was to become the biggest band in the world, Led Zeppelin.
Been dazed and confused for so long, it's not true.
Cream, too, had found themselves on a treadmill of constant touring, and the relentless schedule was beginning to take its toll on the band.
And the colours of the sea bind your eyes with trembling mermaids, and you touch the distant beaches with tales of rain. How his naked ears were
we just worked continually. You know, it was like tour after tour after tour with no real sort of breaks at all. There was no, you know, no holidays.
Apparently we always looked to like a death's door in those days. I think a lot of people used to come to see the Cream to see if Ginger would die, you know, like whereas they'd go to other bands and, you know, because they thought the singer was sexy, they'd come and see us and they'd shout through the window, "You're gonna die tonight, Ginger!"
We'd like do gigs and we'd be really pissed off with it and go, "That was a really bad gig," and yet it's still like, everybody's standing on their feet, screaming and waving and shouting. It got to sort of like the Beatles sort of thing, where we just had to walk on stage and that was enough, which wasn't for us. And then when it got to the point where, you know, it was just so loud and it wasn't enjoyable anymore, and, you know, I can remember Eric coming up to me on the tour and saying, "I've had enough of this," and I said, "Yeah, mate, so have I," and that was, and we decided that was it, there and then, boom.
In November 1968, Cream played their last ever concert at the Royal Albert Hall in London. Manfred Mann, meanwhile, was still consistently hitting the top of the charts.
We found ourselves trapped by having so many hits eventually, though, because people would come up and complain if you didn't play one of them. We started doing medleys, which was like the pits, you know, but it was like to get the hits over as quickly as possible so we could get on to playing something that we enjoyed more, or that was a little more challenging.
You know, it was only later when there were album sales and people were getting better deals that people began to build much longer term careers. For us, it was every 3 or 4 months you needed to have another hit record. For the life that you've left
behind. We broke up in 1969. We had a hit in the charts at that point with a song called Mr. Ragamuffin Man. We all hated it. We loathed it. We loathed the song. We hated the version we'd done of it. And we'd actually spent weeks recording it, putting a lot of effort into what we thought was a piece of drivel. It seemed like, what are we doing? You know, why are we still doing this after 5 years?
After Cream broke up, Ginger Baker and Eric Clapton formed the first supergroup, Blind Faith, with Stevie Winwood of Traffic and Rick Gretsch of Family. Much hyped, they went straight onto the major tour circuit.
Probably, if anybody, I was one of the major people responsible for that, I suppose. You know, I went, "Yeah, this is going to be bigger than Cream. let's go for it." I don't think we even thought about like doing smaller things. No, it was, you know, let's do the big ones.
Blind Faith was ill-starred from the start, and Eric Clapton began to drift away from the band, spending more and more time with the support act on tour.
Eric, at this point, had become very enamoured with Delaney and Bonnie, which later became Derek and the Dominoes, and Eric used to go and join them on stage and bang a tambourine and be with them on stage, just because he thought they were a better band than we were, which I thought was extraordinary. I got totally, I mean, I got really messed up towards the end of the tour, drug-wise. Something, I think, to do with, I was very hurt by like Eric's sort of attitude, so I didn't see anybody or communicate with anybody for 10 weeks after the end of the tour. And when I finally got back to England, the first person I went down to see, Stevie, And Stevie told me, you know, like Eric was off with Delaney and Bonnie and he was getting traffic back together. And that's when I discovered it was no more, sort of thing.
Ginger Baker's next venture was another ill-fated supergroup, Ginger Baker's Air Force. The Air Force never took off, and he decided on a radical change of scenery.
You know, my marriage was going awfully all right, mainly through my own crazy behaviour. Everything was going awfully wrong, you know, and I was sort of still fighting a losing battle with junk, and I just, Africa sort of called me and I went.
Another member of the now-defunct Ginger Baker's Air Force was Graham Bond. After the Air Force folded, he formed a band with Pete Brown. It was to be short-lived.
Our manager at the time came into a rehearsal one day and he said, "Here, I've just been down the record shop and in the remainders bin I found one of yours, Graham, next to one of yours, Pete." And we thought, oh, that's it, that's the writing on the wall, you know.
Graham Bond, now deeply immersed in the study of magic, was still beset by drug problems.
The last gigs we did were really frightening, actually, when he sort of claimed that somebody had made him the chief magician of the British Isles and claimed that he'd invented feedback and just played noise for the whole night. That was the end of it.
In 1974, R&B pioneer Graham Bond was killed by a tube train at Finsbury Park Station. It is not known whether he took his own life. After the Manfred Mann group split up, Manfred Mann the person formed a band with his original partner, Mike Hug.
We had a band, a group, which was Manfred Mann Chapter 3, which was an overreaction against the 60s. That, in retrospect, that was the problem. We had too many rules. We weren't going to have a guitar player. We were only going to do our own material. Everything was the opposite. It was just a mirror image of what we did. And so we went down this unbelievable sort of, you know, sort of route that was just a little too far that side. But strangely enough, we started making money, because the deals were better, people were giving us decent advances. It was beginning to get better, even though we'd failed. That's the joke. Blinded
by the light. His next venture was to be longer lived, Manfred Mann's Earth Band.
The early part of Earth Band was really difficult, you know, to get work in England and stuff. I mean, we were associated with a period, it wasn't regarded as being too credible and stuff, and there was a kind of snobbery around, and it was very, very difficult. But, and we played to very small audiences in place, but I was enjoying playing.
Tom McGuinness and Huey Flint had formed McGuinness Flint in 1970. They had stopped playing regularly when they were invited to start a band with Tom's old colleague, Paul Jones, now a successful actor. In 1979, they went back to their roots and played their first gig as The Blues Band.
It was a tremendous buzz, and it was the sort of buzz that I didn't know was there anymore in live music. You know, to recapture the sort of feeling that I'd had in, say, the Roosters or the early days of the Manfred Band group, as I did with the Blues Band, was like a bonus, you know, after being 15 years in the music business.
Another blues band reunited for a one-off gig in 1993, when they were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Cream.
The rehearsals was magic. It was absolute magic. We just sat down and played, and it was so relaxed and so good. It was probably better than Cream ever was. And it was just wonderful to play together. It was like the last gig we'd done was a week ago, not 25, 26 years. In the 60s, you know, I was enjoying playing, but I was also, you know, really, I was a junkie. I got to being a junkie because, you know, I thought, rightly or wrongly, the junk was enhancing my musical ability. Now I'm at a point where I don't need that. I've got the musical ability and the confidence and the, you know, experience and everything else. I don't need that anymore, and I can now play musically how I want to without even having a drink. You know.
John Mayall moved to Los Angeles in 1969. He is still recording and playing.
The blues is a very honest music. You can't fake it. And of course, for me, it's something that's continually exciting. It never grows old. For me, anyway, it's always fresh. I mean, there's always new things you can do with it every day. And it's always a challenge. So it has the blues has everything in it that I could possibly want. You know, something I'll never get tired of.
More from R&B Night with John Mayall next on BBC 4.